Let's give it up. Let Dr. Clarke know we are in the house. Dr. John Henry Clarke. He's ready to go. He doesn't need an introduction. Here he is, Dr. John Henry Clarke, all the way from Holly Springs, Alabama, Columbus, Georgia. Here he is, Dr. Clarke.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We've got a lot of work to do tonight because many times we use words very poorly. I said recently, black people need to take a course in how to listen, because we talk well, but we do not listen well. Our oppressor is a master teacher. He even teaches us what to do about him. He knows we're not going to learn the lesson because we haven't listened to the lesson very well. He announces a new world order that is not new at all. It's an extension of the old world order. It's an extension of a plan that he has repeated throughout the world. And that plan is whosoever controls the world is going to be a European, one way or the other. It's going to be a European or someone allied with a European. This is why there are some non-Europeans collaborating with Europeans to control the world with the agreement that all of them are going to control us. And we miss the point because we do not know that we are the world's richest people. We have never been a minority. We number a billion people on the face of the earth. A continent, 12 million square miles, belongs to us by every law of God and man, every inch of it, every blade of grass, every grain of sand belongs to us. And we do not understand the message of our greatest messengers who come among us, live and die, and some are killed in front of us, and we never protected them. All right. Okay. Someone asked me recently, do you think we will have another Malcolm X? And my answer was, what did you do with the first one? Faith is stingy in how it sends great men and great leaders and great messages among you. And if you don't make the best use of them, you're going to have to wait a long time before they send another. You're going to have to understand that the major thing we lost in the 15th and the 16th century was the concept of nation management. Nation governance. There is not a single black nation on the face of the earth where blacks manage the wealth-producing resources in their own country. All right. Until you learn how to manage wealth and manage it well, you will not manage a nation. Until you understand the messages that was given to you by able men in the 20th century. Do you understand the self-reliance concept of Booker T. Washington? Stop calling him an Uncle Tom and stop calling him conservative. He was radical, if you understand. He was a strategist whose strategy didn't always work. But he was, if he scratched his head when nothing itched, and if he said yes when he didn't mean yes, he did some quiet timing so that another generation can live to say hell no. And you missed the point. When you grew strong enough to stand before your enemies and say hell no, you wanted to integrate into your enemy. You betrayed Booker Washington. You didn't read his Atlanta Cotton Expedition speech. That was not a compromise. That was a con game. And Booker T. Washington stood before all those people at a critical time in our history, at the end of the 19th century. He tried to be all things to all people. He had a little for the northerner, little for the southerner, little for the blacks. And each time he made one of those high points, he got some more money and kept some more black schools open. So you can build shoes, have repair shops, print shops, entrepreneurship in the black community. Now you got Koreans, everybody running stores in your community except you. Who told you your brain can't conceive and run a store? Now my mental notes for tonight is Africa and the New World Order. I have said there is no New World Order. It's a continuation of the old world order. And that old world order started in Europe. It started among a hungry people coming out of a thawed-out icebox. Stingy, hungry, land poor, resource poor, who decided that they were going to control everything in sight. And if you don't understand that, you're missing the point in how the world operates. If you don't understand white people, you're not going to understand pseudo-white people who do white people's work. You're not going to understand why Ethiopia has been destroyed by pseudo-white people in North Africa, mainly Libya. How then could a small nation like Eritrea, 30 times smaller than Ethiopia, destroy the effectiveness of a big nation like Ethiopia? No serious discussion in the black community. No serious discussion in how fundamentalist Islam played a role in the destruction of an old African nation. The people who went down that Nile and made the nation called Egypt came from Ethiopia. Ethiopia, not Egypt, is the senior nation in all Africa. Now you need to read the chapter in Chancellor Williams' book, Destruction of Black Civilization. It's called Egypt, Ethiopia's Oldest Daughter. Then in John Jackson's Introduction to African Civilization, read the chapter called Ethiopia and the Evolution of Civilization. Then read John Jackson's little pamphlet, Ethiopia and the Origin of Civilization. There's an exhibition at the Schomburg Collection right now that says that Ethiopia was one of the first Christian nations of the world. Ethiopia was not one of the first Christian nations of the world. Ethiopia was the first Christian nation of the world. It was a Christian nation at a time when Europeans were being killed for being Christians. And because you do not understand the flow of history, you do not understand yesterday, you do not understand the day. And you do not understand people who say the same thing using different situations and different words. Now, Booker Washington concept of self-determination and self-reliance use one method. Marcus Garvey was stimulated by Booker T. Washington's program. W.E.B. Du Bois was showing you how to hold it all together politically. Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X would come about the lost nation away from home. All of them were saying the same thing, using different words in different situations. Self-reliance, take care of yourself, feed yourself, clothe your children, educate your children. They were trying to give us back what the slave trade and colonialism took away. Among the 7 books I have written since I've been blind, I have one waiting to be published called Who Betrayed the African World Revolution and Other Major Speeches. I maintain that there was a moment in our history when our enemy thought we were coming to power. And we could have come to power because our enemy was ready to make concessions to us. Then he discovered all of us were jiving. The civil rights people were playing games. They weren't protecting their own community. They were fighting to become a part of someone else's thing other than to build their own thing. They were sending their children to white schools where they're being scarred, cut to pieces psychologically, instead of strengthening the schools in our community to the point where they would be so good that whites would want to come to our schools. They want to go into white schools where white people spit on them. We were missing the point. And while we were going through the ceremony of integration, the substance of planning nationhood missed the point altogether and missed the connection that we had to have with other people in the African world. In the United States, we are a nation within a nation searching for a nationality. Now, can you understand what I mean? We are the most oppressed, the most maligned, the most denied, and the most wounded of all the black people of the earth. Why is that condition so prevailing here in the United States? It prevails in the Caribbean island. I didn't say that was a paradise. Slavery existed there too and was just as bad. They had whipping bosses there. What changed the nature of slavery and the attitude there? They became the majority. And they had a lazy colonizer who let them do the petty administrative work and gave them the illusion of nation. We didn't even have the illusion of nation in the United States. In Columbus, Georgia, a white man drove the truck that picked up the night soil from the privies, the outhouses. All the black people did to gather it and pour it on, but it did not do anything as mechanical as drive the truck. They made a special point in this country keeping us away from technology. In the Caribbean islands, they drove the small ship, mended the small ships, and they were police constables and schoolmasters and district something and others. So they had the illusion of nation, and they had another illusion, which some of them still have, the illusion of England as the motherland. Yeah, just a little bit. Now, it was a lie. It was a fake. But it was not true. But it was at least an illusion. Nobody let us ever be American. America has not broken any promises to us. They never made any. They weren't even talking to us. When they said liberty and justice for all, weren't in the all. And when we go to the place where the all was being given out, they weren't talking about us. What you doing here? Johnny Johnson, a black millionaire, 10 years ago he was worth $200 million reserve. That means money he paid taxes on and salted away. He can no more get a cab at LaGuardia than I can. And all I got is a beat up brownstone house in Harlem, a little pension and Social Security. He would probably have less of a chance. They see him first, he's taller, just as black. I'm saying that you can change your position without changing your condition. We are no further from slavery now than we was after emancipation. Only the new slavery is computerized. And you have the illusion that you're part of somebody else's thing because you cannot understand how some things were set in motion. You cannot understand the nature of education, otherwise you would not expect your enemies to educate your children. It's a contradiction in terms. If your enemy educate your children will come to power and take freedom. They won't ask for it, they will take it. If you educate to rule nations, then you will take a nation by. If Nelson Mandela had any kind of education or political sense, the first thing he would ask for is the return of the land. Land is the basis of nation. All right, suppose South Africa could vote tomorrow. They eliminated apartheid. Tomorrow. The blacks are still poor. The whites still have 87% of the land. They've got the mines and the apparatus. They control the airports. They control the harbors. They control every wealth-producing resource in the country. So they can vote. So what? So they got freedom of speech. So what? They do not have nationhood. You will not have nationhood until you control your wealth and you control your land. And here's what we miss. We always want to cooperate with other people. We want to share with other people. And we will not stand before the European and say, we will share with you in Africa only to the extent that you're willing to share with us in Europe. If you share no land with us in Europe, we share no land with you in Africa. Now let's look at this new world order that is not so new. It's an old world order accommodating some new people, but all of the people in the coalition want to rule over us. Because Africa is the last untapped mineral resource in the world. It is the largest mineral resource in the world. It is the last geographical resource in the world. It is the last underpopulated continent in the world. They want to get away from all that ice. They want to take Africa and repopulate it with Europeans. And the Arab wants Africa just as much as the European, because there are Arabs who wish to depopulate Africa and take it. There are Africans being killed in the Sudan right now solely because they are not Muslims. There are Africans being driven out of Mauritania who are Muslims being driven out solely because they are not Arabs. There are black Muslims who have not lifted their voice against this one iota. There are black Muslims who are teachers of African history and who come to the part of the invasion of the Western Sudan, inner West Africa, from Morocco by the Muslims. They leave that part out. And there's a whole literature on this destruction. This invasion facilitated the spread of the slave trade inland and wrote doom for all the independent states in inner West Africa, in coastal West Africa. The Arab slave trade had already destroyed the independent states in Eastern Africa. We will not deal with the invader who came to stay, but we will rationalize this, said that it's just evil Arabs and not Islam. Every organized religion that was brought into Africa was the handmaiden of a conqueror. Christianity, Islam, and the Hebrew faith. We are confused between Jews and the Hebrew faith. The Hebrew faith is an international faith. There are people who belong to it all over the world. It's not the private property of some Europeans who call themselves Jews. We need not get into the whole concept of Semitism. How can you be anti-Semitic when you don't even know what a Semitic is? The people you are dealing with that you think are Jews are some converted Gentiles from Europe. They played every role in colonialism and slavery that the rest of the Europeans played. As Europeans, when Germany had colonies, they played a role in German's colony. The British had colonies, they played a role in the British colony. When all of them were in the slave trade, they played a role in the slave trade. I didn't say that role was larger than other people's. It was a unique role, but they are business people, and slavery was a business. And they went where they could make profit. They didn't apologize for it. And they gave us no reformation and no apologies. And all of this is well documented. I don't know what people are arguing about. Most of the documents came from their records. They were part of this old world order. Now let's see if we can set it in proper historical focus, because it is so difficult to get you to read a good book on the subject as a good book on damn near everything. All right, now when Greece invaded the Mediterranean under a young man named Alexander, it was a period when Africa had been invaded a lot from Western Asia, mistakenly called the Middle East. The last disastrous invasion came with what is now Iran. About 550 B.C., the Africans cried out, "Oh God, if you cannot send me a liberator, send me a conqueror who will show some mercy." When young Alexander showed some mercy, he did not have to fight his way into Africa. He came in allegedly as that conqueror who would show some mercy. And he did. The kind of mercy he showed is the kind of mercy that has ruined us as a people. He began to mulatto-size the population of Egypt, marry some Greeks into the Egyptian royal families, adopt some African customs, cut some African heads off of statues and put Greek heads on the statues. He did the thing all conquerors do, is to declare war on your culture and make you think less of yourself. War on your religion. And he began to interfere with a thing that is delicate in every land. He began to use his option, the option of every conqueror, to take your women at will. Now, he did not have color prejudice as we know it today, neither did the Romans. Smug, snobbish, impossible, people with high preferences. But after the Roman entered the Mediterranean, they did not want to share as the Greeks wanted to share. They did not want a part of the action. They wanted it all. This is the beginning of Europeans' desire to control everything in sight. This was the old world order that's now re-emerging as a new world order. The Romans destroyed Carthage. After a while, almost 300 years, they killed people for being Christians. There were more Africans killed in the amphitheaters of North Africa than in the arena in Rome. Why you know so much about the killing of the Christians in the arena in Rome? Because Cecil B. DeMille told you so. Spectacular movies. They made no movie about the killing of the African Christians in North Africa and in the amphitheaters of North Africa. They made no movie about the murder of the African Christian woman who created the concept we now know as the Sunday school, Hypatia, killed by a Roman called Peter the Reader, who raped her, threw her bones, threw her flesh into the Mediterranean, and disposed of her bones. Now, this continued because the Romans thought that being a Christian means that you are weak. Only a fool would turn the other cheek. What you do not understand is that what you call Christianity existed in Africa in another form 3,000 years before the birth of Christ. All right. And because you will not read books like John Jackson's Christianity Before Christ, or the pagan origins of the Christ myth, or Percy Graves' 16 crucified saviors, or James Frazier's The Folklore of the Old Testament, you will not recognize the fact that the Bible is mainly folklore and fable. And you accept it as true without examining any of it. And if you examine, you find it is not only not true, but some of it don't make sense. I question the intelligence of anyone who thinks the Bible is true or supposed to be true. Yet I read it as a great book, a fine piece of literature, a great book of spiritual lessons, a great book of allegory, illustrating great spiritual lessons. I take it for what it is. But when Noah plants grapes one day and drink the wine the next day, wine don't ferment that fast. Come on. Nobody ever explained Adam and Eve and their sons and why they got the wives for it, but they were the only people on earth. The flood was supposed to destroy the whole world, didn't touch Asia. If you read James Frazier's three-volume work called Folklore of the Old Testament, one whole volume is devoted to flood stories. All people in the world have that different version of flood story. You know one version of it. The one the Jews preserved for you, that's the one you know about. But you don't know about these other flood stories, these other Noahs. Because you don't read that much. So when people palmed this story on you, you thought it was a new story. John Jackson said that if Christ had risen 2,000 years before, he could have read his own autobiography. Because they picked him up and placed him inside of an already existing story. When St. Augustine heard about the conference at Nicaea, he said, these people are giving us a religion we had 3,000 years ago. They make me laugh. Now, what has this got to do with the New World Order? It has to do with because the imprisonment of your mind around concepts that you have not properly examined had made you a pawn in somebody else's game because you have not examined the game. And the game was to control you. It is a successful game because you have not examined the players and dismissed the game. All right. Now, one day, a Roman emperor looked down in the amphitheater, looked down in the arena. He was enjoying himself seeing the Christians being killed and saw his uncle down there. He said, well, he's a fool anyway. Let him be go. Next Saturday, he looked down and he saw his wife and his son. He said, stop the show. What's to this new religion? So the Romans began to investigate. Finally, the Romans stopped killing Christians and became Christians. And here's an item you need to pay attention to, because no matter what the European believes and what he joins, he intends to control. This is why you fail in the world. You fail to control your community. You fail to control your people. And sometimes you fail to control your family. And this is where it all begins. The control of the community, the control of the family. And no people rises from lower to higher position without exercising some form of discipline. You said, mind your own business. You quite forget, in a collective society that produced us, you are our own business. Everybody is our own business. All right. Now, Constantine, a degenerate, but we'll talk about this later, made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire. Now, at the conference at Nicaea, 325 AD, they began to Christianize this religion, and this religion became the handmaiden of their conquest of other people. Just like Islam became the handmaid of Arab conquest and domination of other people, and it still is. All right. And a black Muslim who don't know this hadn't taken time out to study the faith. All right, now, after the Romans took over Christianity, they declared war on the African Christian for the control of the church, because no matter where the European is in the world, he intends to control. Right. Now, once you understand that, right. You understand why I say the New World Order is a continuation of the Old World Order. Right. Now, the Romans had disgraced themselves in the ruling of Christianity to a point where a camel boy began to grumble He asked for reform. Failing to get reform, he asked for a new religion. The new religion was Islam. The Africans thought that this new religion would get the Romans off of their back. They were right. The new religion got the Romans off of their back, but the new religion replaced the Romans on their back, and that new religion is still on their back. I'm talking about Islam. Every religion that came into Africa from the outside came to oppress the African. Islam, no exception. I wish you understood me on this point. It is to the everlasting credit of African people. We gave the world no religion. We gave the world something higher than religion. We gave the world spirituality, out of which came religion. We gave the world humanity, human feelings. We gave the world the system that a political opportunist and a Johnny come lately called Karl Marx would later call socialism. All right. We had this system thousands of years before. We did not dogmatize it and formulize it. We just lived it out. We lived in collective societies where the wealth was distributed according to the need. The king was the guardian of the wealth, but not the owner of the wealth. And everybody got according to his needs. You thought there was something, when it came from Europe, you said, Karl Marx said it, you thought it was something new. An African pharaoh preached this from a throne 1,300 years before the birth of Christ, named Akhenaten, called the heretic pharaoh. Nothing especially new. But in those river valleys of Africa, we have to understand that Africa created its own world order. And that world order was built around the family, the community, the state, as the collective property of all the people. Our great tragedy in the world is that we have been taken out of the state. We have been deprived of the concept of the state as we originally developed the state. The state is the container for a people's aspirations, for a people's hopes, a people's desire, a people's defense. Now, what happened to the Japanese being defeated, two atomic bombs thrown on them? How could they recover? Why didn't we recover? The Japanese were never taken out of their state physically. They never let the enemy change their educational system. They never let the enemy change the thing that was taken away from us, the image of God as we conceive God to be. All right. None of us today dare speak of God in a language of our own creation. And we dare to imagine God as looking like any one of us. Today in Japan, the Buddha looks Japanese. In Indonesia, he looks Indonesian. In China, he looks Chinese. No contradiction. God must reflect the worshiper. And what do you worship as God? Michelangelo's picture, painted 1,500 years after Christ was dead. How could Michelangelo know how Christ looked? He's dead 1,500 years. Michelangelo paints a picture commissioned by the Pope. Michelangelo gives him a beard. How do you know? Blue eyes, blondish. Michelangelo painted the Last Supper. He needs some models now. He got to have 13 people now. He don't want to pay much money. So he goes to a local jail and gets some people that are not doing anything. That's a bunch of jail boys. You say, here's the Last Supper. Bunch of Italian jailbirds. And you looking dewy-eyed, thinking you looking at a holy picture. Well, you could be right, you could be wrong. You don't think. Think who painted the picture. Every time you see a lion and a man in the picture, a man is chasing the lion. But man painted the picture. When the lion paints the picture, the lion will be chasing the man. At what time are we going to suspend all of this falling for other people's nonsense and look at who painted that picture? All right. Then react accordingly. So the Japanese would not let them take away their God, would not let them take them physically out of the nation of their birth and their development. Now, I have no romance for the Japanese. I think some of them are yellow races. So that's not my point. But when that American kicked open the door and told them, trade with the West whether you like it or not, they took humble and began to trade with the West, send their children to all Western schools, learn that technology. By 1905, they learned so much technology, they kicked Russia's butt in the Sino-Japanese War. Then people began to show them some respect. They came to America, they studied in MIT. Nobody would date a little Japanese. They were lonely. Every see them on Sunday, all alone, taking their little pictures. They take a train, go home and build a train. Take a skyscraper, go home and build a skyscraper. Send their textbooks home, people at home study. Most of the Japanese field officers were trained at the Virginia Military Institute, where they wouldn't even let a black man sweep the floor. They insulted them, almost spit on them. But they were told to get the technology and bring it home. If they smear their body waste in your face, apologize for your face being in their way. And if they bumped into you, they stepped back, humbled, and said, society. They dropped their thank you note at Pearl Harbor. No demonstrations, no leaflets, no fists in the air, no emails. Just went home and did what they had to do. You can't keep quiet long enough to bring off a nation. We need less ceremony and more substance. All right. All right. Now, Islam and African military might pushed the Romans out of North Africa. The Africans and the Arabs controlled Spain and the Mediterranean for almost 1,000 years. After the Crusades, the famines, and the plagues, Europe began to reassert itself. During the so-called Dark Age, the Europeans fed on Europeans with a very poor diet. Finally, they learned maritime skill, mostly from China, the leading maritime nation of that day. this skill preserved by the Africans and the Arabs at the University of Salamanca in Spain, Europe began to get its courage back again. They began to learn latitude and longitude again, began to master ships again, began to go to Asia looking for sweets and spices, something to put on that gosh darn awful European food so they could eat it. Wasn't looking for Africa at first. Discovered Africa on its way, looking for Asia. Then finally, they came to Africa not looking for slaves, looking for an African emperor named Prester John that they thought he was a Christian, hoping he would help them against the Arabs. Finally, an African faker took advantage of these gullible Europeans and wrote a letter to Europe saying, I am the Prester John you've been looking for. I've got so many wives, so many camels, so many things. The letter was a fake. But Europe got its lease on life. At last, somebody gonna help us. They really was turning to Africa for help. They came as guests and stayed as conquerors. Africa's never been protected, not protected now. The people who control that front door let the conquerors in the north. The Africans let them in that western front door, thinking they were friends. The Arabs burst into that eastern door. The Boers, sometimes the French, came into the door from the south. The Africans in the south, seeing these Boers with no land, gave them land, plenty of it, enough of it. No cattle, give them some cattle. And some Africans, seeing them without, some of them without women, gave them women. Can't be a better guess than that. But he forgot one thing about the European that still prevails that you don't understand. He don't play fractions. He wants it all. And his new order is not a new order, it's an extension of the old order. He wants it all. He wants to control all the mineral, all the gold. All right. He wants to produce, control all of the wealth-producing resources all over the world, especially Africa. In the north, he's going to get help from the Africans and the from the Arabs. In the south, he's going to get help from the Boers. Ultimately, Africa is going to have to military itself and drive both of them out of Africa. There must be no place in Africa where an African cannot walk with peace and dignity and with respect. No place. There can be nations in Africa where Arabs live, but there cannot be any Arab-dominated nations to the point where Africans cannot go there at will. Because he, too, is a conqueror. Now, after World War II, there were so many blacks trained in the best military science, skilled assemblymen, skilled signal corps, skilled in tanks, skilled in air force. If we had the organization and the foresight, we could have dressed them in civilian clothes with their uniform and their suitcase and sent them to Africa as visitors. Then at a certain time, they wouldn't go into South Africa as to end apartheid. They'd go and take over all of South Africa. They take it all. You get back from people the same way they took from you. You take it back. You do not bargain with a thief in your house. If a thief is in your house, I have said before, you bargain with the undertaker to take the thief away. if we are going to develop for ourselves a new world order, that new world order has to be based on nationalism, pan-Africanism, and the unification of all African people of the world across all religious lines, all political lines, all color lines. We have to tell all those people got problems with us because the infusion of white blood come in the house and work for the better interest and liberation of all of us, or go to your father's house and see if he'll let you in. But if you're going to stay among us, we expect you to fight for our liberation. All right. Or leave us alone. Get in the house and stay, or go out of the house and stay. There's a billion of us on the face of this earth. We can afford to lose a few people. A few people confused about the color problem, who they're going to be loyal to? Go ahead and be loyal to the other people. Remember now, if we in battle see you in our gun sight, we're not going to hold back the finger because it's you. Our new social order must counter the new social order in Europe, saying they must control everything. We are not asking to control everything. But there's certain geography in this world that belongs to us, and we should control all of it. There should be a hookup between the Caribbean islands, the Africans in the United States, 100 million Africans in Brazil, the 300 million Africans in the Western world, the 750 million Africans in Africa itself, all right, the Africans in Asia, especially the so-called untouchables. You've got over a billion people on the face of this earth. Now, who do we need as an ally other than ourselves? Now let me conclude by talking about our social order and what must our world order be. Our order must be self-reliance, getting back what slavery and colonialism took away. And to do this, we've got to get back our mind, get back our confidence. I'm not impressed by people making beautiful speeches. Open up a shoelace factory. You'll impress me. We can do that. Open up a handkerchief factory. Don't tell me we can't do that. I made a speech 4 years ago in Kentucky at a family meeting. I challenged everybody to make their underwear. At least start manufacturing your underwear. And to get the point across, I put it in the crudest possible way. A people who can't make their drawers can't control a nation. Right. 4 years later, a man and a wife team wrote me, said, we have accepted the challenge. We have the underwear factory. We're sending you a set of underwear free of charge. Look how many people we can put to work. Now, we're just using one item right now, just underwear. And suppose we go to the shoes, we're putting more people to work. Go to the suits, we got to get into wool now. We got to get into sheep and how to shear the sheep and put the wool through the process. Got to divide it to woods. Certain wool that make gabardine, certain wool make certain kind of other wool. All of this, I'm talking about putting people to work. I'm not talking about begging for jobs, I'm about creating jobs. Now, suppose Farrakhan and some of the other leaders who, with their stretch Mercedes Benz, said, I will not ride in a Mercedes Benz until my people make a Mercedes Benz. Right. And suppose Farrakhan stopped playing his violin before a Jewish audience to appease them. What's he got to apologize for? And suppose Jesse stopped crawling on his belly in an international audience. And suppose we get enough nerve to tell all of the leaders, you lead us with dignity, or you don't call yourself a leader. Right. We have more leaders and less leadership than any people in America.
That's right.
Our new social order must be making everybody accountable to us.
That's right.
Every preacher, every store owner in our community, no matter who he is, accountable to us. And every store owner in the community gives something back to the community or get no trade from the community. Every preacher in the community, every church must contribute something to the betterment of the community or we'll put nothing in the collection plate. This new social order must be based on Pan-African and African world nationalism. We must understand what happened to us after the Civil Rights Movement. What happened to the Caribbean Federation? Why did they drive out their leading technicians, advocates? Why did we let King be killed? Why do we still misinterpret Martin Luther King? Why do we keep talking about he had a dream when we forget that he had a plan? Why don't we read the whole speech? He got a dream. He said that near the end of the speech. He said a whole lot of useful things before he said, I got a dream. He was ending the speech then. Read what he said before he said that. He was just tapering it off. And someone else wrote that in the first place. He didn't even write that. Why can't we look at King as a great theologian who tried to give this nation a second chance and the nation didn't appreciate it? This nation is not morally good enough to understand a concept as high as nonviolence. And King did not know enough about the origin and development of nonviolence to be more practical in his approach to it. He said he was following Mahatma Gandhi. He might have tried, but he never knew Mahatma Gandhi.
All right.
Mahatma Gandhi was not an internationalist. Mahatma Gandhi was an East Indian racist, nationalist, and faker. He did nothing for the blacks in South Africa. He was a brown-skinned Englishman. He resented being on the same train car with Africans. If you saw that picture of him, about him, they got most of it historically wrong. He didn't object. The main thing he objected to is not being put out of the white car. He objected to being put in the car with the Africans. He was a Cambridge-trained lawyer. Then finally, the train kept moving further down, and they stopped and put him and the Africans off the train, cleaned the car, and put whites in the car. Then he finally got the point. He still didn't do much for the Africans. He founded the United Natives League, the United Colors League. He would deal with everything except the pure black African. When he left South Africa, Mr. Adorama made a deal with South Africa that if the Indians didn't have to carry the pass, they keep quiet as the Africans carry the path. They're still quiet. Now, if the Africans gain control over South Africa, what are they going to do with those Indians? And there's about 1 million of them. Nobody's addressing themselves over who betrayed the Africa. Mahatma Gandhi went to India and someone ridiculed him for having tweed clothes on in dead summertime, dressed up like an Englishman in that hot country. He learned the high price the British was charging for fabrics. He took off all those British clothes and sent his people to the spinning wheel. Do practical things. Martin could have done this. But I'm saying that Martin did a whole lot of useful things we need to look at honestly while doing some impractical things too and not understanding that this nation would never have bought any nonviolence. Nonviolence is too good for them. They are morally not equal to a tactic as high as nonviolence. And yet he left a message for us as a people. And he never understood that Mahatma Gandhi was a B actor. Most of his fasts were fakes. He would tell the British, I'm going to fast into death. And the British thinking this is going to tipple the British Empire, would literally beg him to eat. And he would fast about 30 days. And finally, he would go in, bowing and scraping, sighs. What would you give me if I eat? Each time, he would give concession. Each time, he would get more. He would never get all he asked for, but he would always ask for more than he expected to get. When he put forth his 21 demands, he got 14. When he put forth his 17 demands, he got 10. And the man they denied him on the one trip, the first on the list on the next trip. He was a supreme strategist. But if you think he was universal, then you don't know him. He didn't have nothing to say about the Chinese next door who was being pushed around by the Japanese. He did practically nothing of consequence for the so-called untouchables of India. He expressed some sympathy for them, but he didn't do much to change their lot. Now, had King known more about it, he would have chosen another model. Akhenaten, a pharaoh of Egypt who outlawed warfare, thought so much of life he would not crush a flower. He could have chosen the example of Shamba Bolongongo in the Congo, who also outlawed warfare, gave equality to his ministers. Erected a law in the Congo, I still don't quite understand. Fathers of twins got more from the state than fathers of single children. And he would never argue with his ministers in public for fear it might hurt their feelings. So they would walk someplace out of earshot and argue. Very humane. But there are many humanitarians in Africa. He could have modeled after, had he known enough of African history to choose them or listen to other people. There was a bunch of hustlers around Martin Luther King. There's a hustlers around all of them. Sometimes the information did not get through. This atmosphere saw the emergence of Elijah Muhammad, who I respect a great deal, although I have never felt a burning need for any form of organized religion, though I grew up a Baptist and was a Baptist Sunday school teacher. I've always been a highly spiritual human being, and I pray in my own way, not on my knees. I try to do something of consequence for my people every single day of my life without expecting anything in return. I have always said service is the highest form of prayer. Serve somebody. Do something. Find an African student who came here with his tropical clothing in the wintertime and see if you can get him an overcoat. Something. Just do something for somebody. I always thought prayer was somewhat of a waste of time for me. Meditation I do often. Sometime early in the morning, sometime late at night. I made very good use of aloneness without ever being lonely. I read a lot. When I had my eyesight, now I listen to all kinds of tapes and I juggle my reading machine. But I keep up because I consider it an honor and a privilege to be the servant of my people. Because if the best thing I can do is to render a service, I think we need to examine everybody who calls themselves a leader. And we need to ask some serious questions about leaders. First and foremost, we need to ask, leader, where are you leading me? A story is told about blacks seeing white people get on a train. And so the blacks scramble to get on the train just because white people own the train. Finally got down the road and one black person asked, where is the train going? And the engineer, who was the devil, said, the train is going to hell. Before you jump on every bandwagon, find out where it's going. Before you join any religion, find out what it's meaning. And realize, if God is in everything, God is in you. And that the ancient Africans did not use a church. And when the British and other missionaries came to Africa and built a church and said, this is God's house, the Africans said, if God can make the wind bring back the spring in the summer, make an earthquake, stop one, he couldn't fit into a little house like that. So what are you people talking about? Made no sense that you fit him into the house. He's bigger than the house. He's part of the totality of the world. I have been, since 1958, my first visit to Africa, an African traditionalist. I do not believe Africa needs any of the organized Western religions. I think the African traditional way of life is humane, it has dignity, it has respect. I deplore the fact that every African nation is an imitation European state. I think Africans need to go back to Africa, stop being Africans with African bodies and European minds and European values. I have serious questions about any African's worthiness to rule an African nation who is not married to an African woman. You must be symbolically what you profess to be. I think the wall between the black man and the black woman is a phony wall started by white sociologists. We think we can pick up that scenario. We got to fight each other because they say we must fight each other. We have to remember, we came out of society, but we created and accepted the first female gods. It didn't demean a single one of us. None of us lost any manhood because of it. The first woman who ride at the head of a state was in Africa. And her armies were almost all men. She didn't send her men into battle. She led them into battle. All right. All right. No manhood was lost. We are not Europeans. We don't have European values. We should not have Europeans' concept of the role of a woman. Dr. Nichols illustrates this beautifully in one of his lectures. He kicked history back 10,000 years. He showed that Europe had short seasons in that ice. He must harvest, store, all of these things in 3 or 4 months. So everybody had to work. Then he'd go back in his cave. And if he got angry with his wife, and if he said, get out, she had to go out into the snow and freeze to death. So she began to cop a plea. The white woman is still copping a plea. But in Africa 10,000 years ago, when the woman had domesticated animal life, had started agriculture, had started her drugstore, which was the rainforest, she would go out and get something to cure her man, tan the leather as part of his clothes, sharpen his spear. Suppose he told her, get out. She'd look at him like a fool. Get out of where? Who's going to take care of you? So our attitude toward women started all different from Europe. And we are wrong when we try to fit our attitude into his attitude. No white beaters came out of Africa. No wife deserters came out of Africa. There were no single woman without husbands in Africa. These societies had order. And if after a certain time a girl didn't have a husband, the society made itself responsible for getting one for her. No one asks, are you in love with him? Here is a decent man to be your husband. Now, to your romantic Western mind, this might sound bad. But remember, in that society, everyone got one. And you're still looking. And can't find one. I'm not saying that we can reconstitute all old societies, but let's reconsider the values of the society. All right. Let's reconsider the concept of nation as we conceive the nation to be. All right. We had no tight borders. The African did not have the nation state. He had the territorial state, clusters of states. Side by side, each exchanging people, exchanging cultures, exchanging goods and service. So therefore, between the exchange, there was enough for everybody. No one extremely rich, no one extremely poor. But we got along. The family was the heart of the community, and the community was the heart of the state. The village is still the heart of Africa. Go away from these European-made cities and go into the hinterlands of Africa, as I've done many times. Africa's not hopeless. Once Africa's rescued, once Africa's barriers are rescued, once we understand the nature of international African, pan-Africanism and nationalism, and a concept of African socialism that developed before Europe, we can develop our own social order that will give a new humanity, not only to ourselves, but to the whole world. Right. Nothing came out of Europe that is in our favor. No freedom-loving people came out of Europe. No freedom movements came out of Europe. That world order is to control. Our new world order is to be independent of their control. So we're meeting on a collision course. And in that collision, we're going to have to win. We're going to have to win for our children and realize that freedom is something you take with your own hands. You protect it with your own hands. No one leaves it to you in a will. Each generation must secure it for itself. Let us secure it for ourselves and will the desire to the next generation, so they will, in turn, will the desire to their children and the still more beautiful ones waiting to be born. That is tomorrow's work. I conclude by saying to you, if you are serious about tomorrow's work, you will start it today.
Dr. John Henry Clarke, let's give him a big hand.